So, what are we doing here? We're going to talk about a book that started out for me years ago when I was a graduate student. My wife found a little pamphlet in the back of an old bookstore and said, would you like this? And I said, well, it looks interesting, and it's only $2, so what the heck? Yeah, I'll take it. That became a paper for a legal history class, and then it grew from there into a project that several professors told me couldn't be done because there's not enough records and enough material. And when I got to 643 pages in my dissertation, James, they said you could stop now. And so I did. And I sent it to LSU Press. We cut it in half. And this is the book that you see. It came out in 1994, and it's been a very long time since then. But every 2 or 3 months, I get a phone call. Somebody wants to hear about the great hanging at Gainesville, Texas. And just this past Monday, I was invited to come up to Gainesville, Texas, where a lot of the locals put on what we would call a dramatic reading. First time that's ever been done in that format. Second time it's ever been staged at all. And there were over 200 people packed into that room to see what they had to say and see the perspectives that were presented. And of course, they hauled me up on the stage after it was over to answer questions. So this is a topic that has a half-life of plutonium. It blew up, as I said, from a small graduate project. I had no idea how deeply it affected people's lives, the history of a region, the history of a country in many ways. Because I've been flown halfway across the country to give my talk on the Great Hanging at Gainesville, Texas, sometimes to Army officer groups who, in the wake of 9/11, wanted to discuss how do these things blow up? What happens? Why do people do what they do? Did not have any idea that that's where we were going when we started this project. But here it is, years later. There's a blog site devoted to it. There are reunions going on. It's really been an amazing ride. What is it that catches people's attention? Well, it's a pretty riveting picture, isn't it? Absolutely inaccurate. How many Texans we got in here? How many trees in Texas could hold 20 dead bodies? Nah, this is Texas, right? This is an artist's rendition. If you flipped open your paper in New York City, February the 20th, 1864, this was the centerfold. Probably made you spit your bagel right out, didn't it? If you look at the details, it's pretty grim stuff. What is this? This is what introduced the North in a graphic way to this story. And what happened is on October the 1st, 1862, the local militia in Cook County fanned out and arrested over the next few days over 150, possibly 200 people. They herded them into an empty store on the Gainesville Square. A vigilante court was organized, all done very democratically. Everything was voted on. And in the next 2 weeks, they convicted and executed 42 people. 40 by hanging, 2 who chose to run, knowing what hanging might be like, and were shot. 42 people killed in the space of 2 weeks makes it the largest extra-legal or illegal, whichever word you want to use, mass hanging in U.S. history. Everything's bigger in Texas, right? From that point forward, it became a national news event. Even the London Times carried articles on what had just happened in Cook County, Texas. Was it the only place this happened? No. Similar events on a much smaller scale took place throughout the Confederacy. It's part of that understanding that the Confederates, just like we are today, didn't agree with each other, and sometimes they did ugly things to each other. Is it the only event in Texas? Absolutely not. It's not even the only place people were hanged during what we call the Great Hanging. But since only 1 to 5 people were hanged in other locations, Gainesville, as the location of 40 deaths, becomes the most closely associated with it. And so it became known as the Great Hanging at Gainesville, Texas. And then we'll talk about after the war, what happens then? How does it play out? What do they do about this after the war if, in fact, the whole country is put on notice? But we'll get to that a little bit later. First, let's deal with the immediate question. 150 people arrested, 42 dead. How did neighbors do that to each other? Because this is a very small area. There's only 4,000 people in Cook County when this took place, and only about 300 people live in Gainesville. If you hanged a man, chances are you knew him, or you knew somebody who knew him. Why would they do this? Simple words that I always use, this is a pressure cooker. In 1862, when all this happened, it had been a building conflict for many years. First of all, this area was very newly settled. Most of the people who lived in Cook County and in the area around here, including over here at McKinney, were new arrivals. The area was very, very thinly populated until about 1858, they built a stage road through here that came in across the river around Denison, came through North Texas, and ended up somewhere in Southern California. You could actually ride all the way from St. Louis, Missouri, to California on a stagecoach or a series of wagons. There was a reporter who did this. He took a steamboat home. He said, having ridden that all the way here to San Diego, I'm not going back. It's not a very good road, but it's enough to bring people in. Land is free, or virtually free, and so people poured in. With them came that conflict that was already dividing the South. White people brought black slaves into North Texas. The idea was to raise a market crop, probably cotton. By the way, this is a fascinating picture, isn't it? And you've probably seen pictures like this in your textbooks or other books. This picture was actually taken in Dallas County in 1907. Tell me the Civil War changed North Texas a lot. This is what Dallas County still looked like 50 years after the war was over, 40 years after the war was over. But with the black slaves came questions of conflict, of class. There were people who did not want slaves, particularly since most of these people who poured in this region came from the Upper South. They already were squabbling over the issue of slavery. They were also very mistrustful of the slaves themselves. There had been conflicts going all the way back to the Nat Turner Revolt of 1831, the Denmark-Vesey Conspiracy, the collapse of the Haitian government, and the liquidation of the white population there. This is a mistrust and a fear and a conflict that goes way back. Now it's coming to North Texas. Think about it. How many Tennesseans fought for the Confederacy? About two-thirds of them. One-third fought for the Union. Kentucky was bitterly divided. The Carolinas divided. Virginia even divided. And all of these are the people that are living in North Texas as the Civil War approaches. Second problem, Indians. Comanches specifically, as well as their allies, Kiowas, Arapahoes. The Indians were always raiding, always pressing back, always trying to push that line of white settlement back east. Take cattle, take horses, etc. Always the fear with a full moon that the Comanches were coming. In fact, they often called it the Comanche moon. So, what if you heard your neighbors were actually working with the Indians, willing to buy the stuff they stole, or allying with them to help attack you? What if you already knew these people to be questionable on the slave issue? They didn't like you bringing slaves into the area. They didn't like slaves being here. All these things are questions to be asked. Excuse me, I have a cold, so you have to put up with me. If the Indians came, who defended your house? You did. It's the militia. We call them Texas Rangers now, but generally speaking, if there was a large Indian raid or a large operation, the governor would issue permission for volunteers to take the field for 3 to 6 months. Those volunteers were you, or your dad, or your brother, or your neighbors. There's no police. There's no state highway patrol. There's no Texas Rangers as we know them today. None of that. That also means, what if you had suspicions about your neighbor being a thief? Who took care of that problem? Turn to your community leaders, and generally they might point right back at you. So it's a pressure cooker building, isn't it? People pouring in, trying to make a living, already bitterly divided over some important issues, and now we throw in Indian attacks. That'll make them unhappy. And what else? What's this? This is Bleeding Kansas. 1854, as people poured west to the north of Texas, questions were raised about whether slavery would be allowed to go into areas previously closed by the Missouri Compromise. 1820, Missouri, Southerners were not interested in Kansas. By the 1850s, they might want to move there. Maybe they would use slaves to start market agriculture in Kansas. So we changed the rules a bit. Rather than make a decision, Congress said, let's let the people in Kansas vote on whether they want slavery. And in the good old American tradition, what's one of the best ways to win an election? Kill everybody that'll vote the other way, right? We're good at that. We also cheat. So Kansas, asked to vote on slavery, became Bleeding Kansas by the summer of 55, 56. First referendum on slavery in Kansas was held. There are 1,600 registered voters in Kansas. Over 6,000 ballots were cast. Small mathematical problem, isn't it? Is Kansas that far from Texas? You get kind of nervous, don't you? When violence, and we're talking hundreds of people dying in Kansas fighting over the slavery issue. Bleeding Kansas was in the newspapers. What if those people spilled down here? What if they wanted to slug it out over whether we would or would not have slavery in North Texas? What if your suspicious neighbor, who's only been here a couple of weeks after all, what if he is one of those Kansas abolitionists? What do we do then? Who's going to protect us? What do we do about such people? Such people as John Brown. Now, a lot of you are familiar with John Brown's story, right? He took over the Harper's Ferry Arsenal, October of 1859, issued a call to all the slaves in the area to come to the arsenal, which is now in West, by God, Virginia, and he would give them weapons. Now, never mind that no black person in the area was apparently crazy enough to respond to a strange-looking white man's call and go down there and risk their lives and limbs by joining up with his rebellion, he represented to Southerners a clear and present threat. I mean, they felt pretty comfortable politically up till this time. A lot of debate, yes, I know. But if you really tallied up the debates by the late 1850s, the South controlled the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court had held that Congress could not stop slavery from going anywhere in the Dred Scott decision. The South controlled the Senate and pretty much had a working alliance, we would say, in the House most of the time. What does John Brown represent? He represents a new breed of Northern abolitionists who doesn't care what the Supreme Court says, does he? Does he really care what Congress says or what they're going to work out in a compromise? No, he's going to give them guns and he's going to turn them loose on you. That upset many Southerners, including Texans. And let's back it up a couple of years. Where'd John Brown's career start? Who's the first people he killed? Kansas. Those Kansas people are crazy. What if they come to North Texas? And then in the summer of 1860, we thought they did. In the midst of kind of watching our new neighbors, or maybe we're new to the area ourselves and we're not real sure about the balance of power and how the game is played around here, in the midst of watching for Indian attacks, and there were some grisly ones, in the midst of worrying about what's happening in Kansas, not that far away from us, and wondering if there's a John Brown under our bed tonight, suddenly fires exploded all across North Texas in the summer of 1860. It was July 1860. Fires started probably first in Dallas. They will be reported as far south as Waxahachie, as far north as Denton, Texas, where the fire broke out in a back warehouse or back storeroom of a local hardware store and set off 25 kegs of black powder, flattened half of what was then Denton, Texas, at least the part around the square. They were reported as far east as Jefferson, as far west as Weatherford. Mysterious fires. Who is setting these fires? Well, some said Oh, that's those new matches that have been introduced, railroad matches. They're apparently not very stable compound of phosphorus and sulfur. And since it was 108 degrees that day, and that's been recorded in several places, unair conditioned, tightly packed boxes, all of this combined creates combustion, and we get fires in the hardware stores. But others said no. John Brown had allies, didn't he? He had friends. Some of those crazy people from Kansas, they talked the slaves into doing this. I know this. I saw them talking three slaves under a tree a couple of months ago. I wondered about it then. Now I know. And newspaper editors lined up. A lot of newspaper editors wrote, we've tested these matches. We took 10 of those matches and we laid them out there on the sidewalk. We stared at them a good 10 minutes. Didn't catch on fire. Obviously, that theory is bunk. We know it was slaves. We know it was abolitionists. So all over North Texas, and a good friend of mine, Don Reynolds, has written this book about it, we rounded up slaves, we hanged them in Dallas, we hanged them in Weatherford. Weatherford didn't do it very well. They had a town well, and apparently they don't have very strong trees in Weatherford, so they started hanging people from the cross piece on the town well and then cutting the rope. Well, think about it. After they did that about five times, they began to realize, damn, we can't get any water out of the well now. It's all fouled up. Well, that wasn't too smart. Okay. True story. You would think they'd have figured that out before they started dropping them in the well. But several hundred slaves and whites were rounded up. Probably a couple of dozen were executed. Probably the most famous execution was Anthony Bewley. He was a Northern Methodist minister who was determined to preach against slavery in the South. He kept coming down here, and when all of this exploded in the summer of 1860, he became a target. He knew he was a target. He ran away. He got all the way to Missouri. The Texans caught him, brought him back, and hanged him over here in White Settlement. Then they buried him, but, you know, abolitionist, he doesn't deserve a good hole. So his knees stuck out of the ground, so it wasn't hard to find him. So they dug him up, and the local physician boiled him. Didn't have a skeleton, and skeletons were expensive to put on display in your office, so he made Bewley his skeleton. While he was drying him on the shed, the local people used to go out there on Saturday nights after having a couple of beers and pose Bewley. That was one of the sporting things to do on a Saturday night. In case you thought this was an obscure person, anybody here from Fort Worth? You ever heard of Ephraim Daggett Middle School? That was Dr. Ephraim Daggett who boiled Bewley. That's not in his biography, by the way. I don't think his grandchildren wanted to remember that. Not practical, you know. Skeleton lying out there in the prairie, let's go use it. So, you're scared of Indians, you're a little concerned about your new neighbors, you're scared to death of those crazy abolitionists from Kansas are coming down, and now they're not just over there in Virginia, they're in your backyard, aren't they? Every town established patrols to watch. Every town had somebody that they ran out during this period of time. And in this lovely frame of mind, the South lost control, it thought, of the government. A purely abolitionist president from a purely abolitionist party, the Republican Party, committed to eradicating the twin relics of barbarism in American life, slavery and polygamy. They hated Mormons too. So, Abraham Lincoln wins. He doesn't win the South. In fact, he didn't win a single county in Texas, but now he's your president. So if you believe that many, many Northerners are like John Brown, and they're infesting your counties, but the one thing that might keep you safe is a government still under your control, but oops, the North just took control of the White House, and who appoints the Supreme Court? The White House, and on down the chain. It wouldn't be that hard to talk you into believing that maybe it's time to do what? Erect another legal barrier between you and those crazy abolitionists, right? Let's leave the Union. Was anybody speaking a little more rationally in this period of time? Sam Houston was. Sam Houston said, I'm sorry, guys, but I think it was the matches. And as far as the idea that our area is infested with abolitionists, come on. Third, I've met the North. You don't want to start a war with them. They will win. It's not going to be pretty. So when Texans said, let's hold a convention and vote on secession, Houston said no. So they went around him. They held elections anyway. So Houston called the legislature in, said, I want you to say no to that convention. The legislature voted yes to the convention. Many of the legislators had already been elected delegates to the convention. And that convention adopts this. It's an ordinance of secession to leave the Union. Overwhelmingly, they voted to adopt an ordinance to leave the Union. But in the midst of it, there were a few voices still saying, now wait a minute. Maybe it wasn't the Yankees that stirred up the Indians. Maybe these new people come in and aren't so bad. Maybe there's not as many abolitionists as you think, and maybe the slaves aren't as dangerous as you think. One of them is one of your local folks here, James Webb Throckmorton. He is the first guy to stand up. Now think about this. It's a roll call vote. Everybody, they call your name. You say yes or no to secession in this convention. You get all the way to the T's before the first guy says no. And that was James Webb Throckmorton of McKinney. The gallery started booing and hissing. Throckmorton stands back up and says, Mr. President, when the gallery hiss, well may patriots tremble. And he sat back down. We'll see him again in this story. About 8 people out of 170 delegates actually voted against secession. So it passed overwhelmingly, but the convention did one thing that Houston asked them to do. Allow the people of Texas to vote on secession. Before it really becomes the law, before we really sever the ties with the U.S. that we just forged 16 years ago, let's ask Texans what they think. The result was this. This is a secession vote. And again, all this leads to pressure in Cook County. Why? The purple state counties are the ones that did not vote for secession. Here's your hill country counties, a blend of Tennesseans and Germans who were unionists, not interested in severing the ties with the United States. I wrote an article one time on this little county way out here. The best I can come up with, it's a bunch of white trash from Mississippi. And you never know what they're going to vote for. Ask me where I was raised. Ocean Springs, Mississippi. I didn't find that such a hard article to write. I was looking for some relatives. But up here, look what's happening up here. Some of these new people came in on that wagon road, the Butterfield Overland Stage Road. A majority of them voted no. 3/4 of Texans voted yes to secession, but there's these 10 counties up here and these 18 counties down here that voted against secession. So guess where most of the violence against unionists is going to take place in the Civil War? Any of y'all ever been to the Union at Comfort, at the Union Monument at Comfort, Texas? Ever heard of the Nueces River Massacre? That was here. And up here, we have the Great Hanging at Gainesville, Texas. Yellow. These are counties that, as far as we know, did not return ballots, or they were attached to other counties for reporting their votes. So, for example, I know some of these counties down here in the Nueces Strip, they didn't officially record ballots, but if you look in the ballots in the electoral records for these counties, you'll find that their ballots are reported there. There were so few cast, I guess. Places like Duval County, Starr County, Webb County, that sort of thing. So now, keep in mind that all the factors that I just talked about don't go away because the war started. In fact, they get worse, don't they? People still pour into Texas. In fact, more people will be pouring into Texas and bringing more slaves because Missouri and Arkansas and Tennessee, those are all battlegrounds now. You want to get out of there, don't you? So you bring your stuff and your problems to Texas. The Indians, they're not going to take, it's not going to take them that long at all to figure out, wait a minute, if they left the Union, all those soldiers that were out in those forts, they're gone. Party for us, right? Somebody's got to do something about that. And it wasn't the Eastern Indians. They kind of split half down the middle. Half of them supported the Confederacy, half supported the Union. It was the Western Plains Indians, the Kiowa, the Arapaho, Cheyenne further west, and definitely the Comanches. They had no alliance. They saw business opportunity, and they will take it during the war. They don't just call a holiday just because North and South are fighting. And as far as abolitionists, maybe there's more of them coming in with these new people. If they were here before the war, they probably surely still are, and there might be more of them. How do you cope with this? To the forefront steps William C. Young, local leader in Cook County, former U.S. Marshal. He had commanded a regiment in the Mexican War. He owned more slaves than anybody else in Cook County, 53. Very well-to-do man, former state legislator, a man whom the community respected. And Young said, what we're going to do here, folks, is we're going to organize a regiment. But I promise you, we'll never be sent away from North Texas. And so many who had voted against secession find themselves enrolled into the 11th Texas Cavalry, CSA, Confederate. The Lieutenant Colonel, James Webb Throckmorton. Because the purpose of the regiment was what? Was it going to go to some far-off place and fight battles against Yankees? No. Young promised, it's going to stay here. So they marched in the Indian Territory. As Union troops left the forts in the Indian Territory, the 11th Texas Cavalry and other small units occupied them. They went as far north as Chustanala, if you've ever been there. Fought a big battle at Chustanala in December of 61. So far, so good. And then Young was overruled. The Confederacy sent the 11th Texas Cavalry to Mississippi in the spring of 62. Things were going bad in Mississippi, right? The Confederacy had lost, was being beaten, so they needed reinforcements. Within 3 months of the 11th Texas Cavalry arriving in Mississippi, two-thirds of them packed up and went home without leave. And one of them that packed up and went home, though he did file his paperwork, was William C. Young. He said he had a tummy ache. They gave it a shot, didn't they? So what'd they do when they got home? They did what many of their neighbors were doing. They sat down. They got farms to run, don't they? They got children to feed, schools to run, Indians to watch for, maybe some abolitionists, you never know. New people coming in, all kinds of pressure, all kinds of concerns. So I'll tell you what I'm going to do, a lot of them said. Whether or not they were hardcore unionists, I have things that I think are more important than this new Confederacy. So I'm just going to sit this one out. Except they're not going to be allowed to do that. The Confederacy in the spring of 62 was hurting. This is a map that shows how much of Confederate territory is being lost at different parts of the war. By this particular point in time, there we go, all of this had been lost to Union invasions. The Mississippi River is being lost, except right here at Vicksburg. There are Union incursions on the coast of North Carolina, Virginia. Down here at Savannah has already fallen. New Orleans is gone. The state capital of Tennessee, Nashville, has been lost to the Union. The northern half of Arkansas is gone. Confederate attempts to take New Mexico failed. So the Confederacy needs to adopt desperate measures. And here is where dissent, or just sitting it out, becomes, in the eyes of many people, treason. The Confederacy adopted a draft law. They will eventually draft everybody between the ages of 17 and 60. And 80+% of Southerners will go in under these draft laws. Second, how do you feed them? New taxes. And you know how Texans love taxes, right? I know. Say that three times fast and see if you don't mess it up. But taxes were something that they did not want, and now they're going to have to pay them to support the Confederacy, to feed all these men, to buy weapons for them. Now, the taxes will only cover so much. Third, something called impressment. They can now come to your farm, say, hey, Bob, looks like you got three pigs out there. Well, you only got two kids, so we're going to take those two pigs. We'll leave you one for the winter. or half your corn, or that extra cow, or that really nice shotgun you got there. Now, they'll pay you for it. They'll give you an IOU or some of that genuine Confederate money that you value so much. What they talk about, an egg cost a dollar in 1861, $12 by 1864. Can you eat an IOU? Can you feed your kids on that Confederate money? No. You'd just as soon have the cow or the pig or the corn or that shotgun, wouldn't you? You don't have a choice. It's called impressment. So sitting at home, taking care of your family, it's not going to happen, is it? So quite a few North Texans who had never supported secession, who are a little worried about their neighbors, who are scared of Indian attacks, who are kind of worried about those crazy abolitionists from Kansas, who, by the way, by this time, a lot of them are now wearing uniforms and have been organized into Union regiments pushing down through the Indian territory. They don't want to be drafted. They don't want to pay those taxes. They want to use that stuff that they've got to support their families. So they begin to sign up with what was called the Peace Party Conspiracy. Now, there were several levels of this. Most of them, it was a protection-type organization. If the draft man came for you, or if the impressment man came for you, you could run to your neighbor's house, give the secret signals, give the password, and he would hide you, or your pig, or your corn. But there were a few more ardent Unionists who thought a permanent solution might be to help the Union Army invade North Texas. And that's what Confederate authorities began to hear, that there were people in North Texas willing to help the Union Army invade. So, to enforce the law throughout Texas and in North Texas, martial law was declared. The whole state was put under martial law. And every county had a provost marshal. It's his job to carry out the law, the martial law. For Cook County, it was James G. Borland, who had been Young's second in command in the Mexican War. He had been a tax collector for the Republic of Texas. He had been a ranger. During the 1850s, if you needed rangers to go out and chase Indians, Borland was the guy that usually got the 3 to 6 month command, and he would organize the volunteers and take them out. A tough man, a hard man. One of my favorite quotes is, he was a good fighter and a good hater. Borland saw the world in black and white, I believe. You were for him or against him. You were the enemy or a friend. There was no in between. Good guy to put in charge of the draft and the taxes and the impressment in Cook County, right? And he ruled with an iron hand. Stories began to circulate. Allegedly, he even had a woman hanged for intemperate remarks made during the course of her husband's trial. Her husband was arrested as a draft dodger. He had a very simple choice. You can be hanged or go into the Army. He went into the Army 2 weeks after he left. According to the stories, some of Borland's people, either women or men dressed as women, showed up at Mrs. Hillier's house and hanged her for the acid-tongued remarks she had made during the trial. Borland was not a patient man. So the stories begin to circulate. He forms an investigation committee. He's not going to have a peace party in his county. And he brings together men who think like him, prominent local leaders, such as William Hudson, commander of the local militia, Samuel C. Doss, another large slaveholder. All of these are men that he can work with. They infiltrate the organization. They get information. And they send a letter in September of 62 to the governor, Francis Lubbock. They say, "Dear governor, we got a problem up here. We got this peace party conspiracy. We don't know how big it is or how dangerous these people are. But would you please send us some troops so we can kind of take charge up here and reestablish control?" And the governor wrote back, "I don't have anything to send you guys. I got nothing. I got Yankees in Galveston. I got a blockading fleet off the coast. Jeff Davis up in Richmond is begging for every troop I can send him. Texans are battling in Arkansas and the Indian. I got nothing to send you. But I tell you what, y'all do what you need to do," and this is almost a quote, "and I'll back you 100%. In fact, anything you spend, I'll reimburse you every dime that you spent. You have an absolute green light from the executive mansion to do what you think needs to be done. So on October 1, 1861, Hudson calls a militia muster as he had done before. And the guys that show up, they're the loyal ones, right? They're the good guys. Who are they going after? The guys who refuse to come, right? It's simple now. You know who the enemy is. They're the guy who didn't show up this morning. Now, he might tell you he had a cold or the flu or his big toe had the gout in it, but we know better, right? He's one of those disaffected ones. He's one of those newcomers that, hell, he doesn't want to pay his taxes. He doesn't want to be drafted. He's probably a Yankee. Check it out. So that's what they did. And this is, again, Frederick Sumner escaped, told a newspaper reporter they hired an artist, and this is what they thought it looked like as they were being brought in by the militia in Texas and locked into that store on the town square. So an excited crowd gathers in the center of Gainesville. What are they going to do? Let's hold a trial. Well, who will run the trial? William C. Young. He's the richest, most experienced politician in town. We trust him. When the war began, we turned to him to command our regiment, didn't we? He's the guy that led a regiment in Mexico. He'll know what to do, so they made him the prosecuting attorney. And Young, with the help of Borland and others, organized voting. They voted. They elected a panel of five good and true men, who then selected a jury of 12 to hear every case of those 150 to 200 men locked up in the store. Now, meanwhile, a few Confederate units, company size, are trickling in. The town is fairly well defended, and more prisoners are picked up. They agree to hold the court hearings in this building here. It's burned down a long time ago. Why did they hold the meeting in a store? Because they had a courthouse, but Jim Doss's bull got in it the year before and knocked it all a kilter, so it really wasn't usable. Imagine what kind of courthouse you have if one large bull can knock it over. So they all file up, the court files up, the jurors file up to this basically a big open space on top of Robert Scott's store, which is where the commissioner's court had been meeting anyway. And in fact, they were sworn in as they sat down by R.G. Piper, the county judge. Now, he didn't have the authority to preside over capital cases, but he swore them in and let them do it. And so the trials began. They quickly convicted in 1 week seven men. Each one of them was put in the back of a wagon on the appointed day, driven out to the hanging tree on California Street where it crossed Pecan Creek by Bob Scott. Bob Scott was a local slave. He belonged to the same Scott fellow who owned the store. And Bob Scott had promised his owner that he would take care of the family while his owner was away in the army. So that's kind of, I guess, the way Bob Scott looked at it. He would drive the wagon out. You would stand up in the back of the wagon. They put a noose around your neck, and Bob Scott would drive the wagon out from under you. If you were smart, you jumped hard. It would break your neck. If you weren't, it could take you 20 minutes to strangle. When you stopped flailing around, they would cut the rope. Bob Scott would then drive you back to the store where a back storeroom was used to throw the dead bodies. Seven. At that point, there's a rebellion on the jury. The jury had been voting by a majority vote whether to convict or not. At this point, Thomas Barrett, a Church of Christ minister, a slave owner, said, "This is wrong. Y'all are railroading these men." And so he forced the jury to switch to a two-thirds vote because he said, "Otherwise, I'm going to walk out of here. I'm going to break the jury." So he went to a two-thirds vote, and at that point, they quit convicting people. They couldn't get a two-thirds majority. Barrett thought that would bring things to an end. At the end of the week, seven men had been convicted and hanged. One more had been shot. The jury said, "I guess our business is done. We've heard everybody's trial. We can't let them go, though, because there's a mob swarming out there. They could be shot down the streets if we let them go. So what we're going to do is we're going to wait 1 week. They'll be safe in the store. We'll feed them. They'll be taken care of. We'll come back in 1 week. We'll notify their families to come get them. We'll let them go 1 week from today. Today's Saturday. Okay. Sounded good. Except at that point, two Confederate officers walked in, having heard that the jury was adjourning without hanging anymore, demanded a list of all the prisoners, picked 14, which I think was kind of a 1 out of 10 sort of situation, and took them out of the store. Now, these men had already been acquitted. They were taken out of the store, placed in another place, and hanged on Sunday and Monday. That shocked Barrett, but what could he do? He watched as Bob Scott again drove the hanging wagon, this time 2 by 2. This is when one of the most famous victims of the Great Hanging was killed, Nathaniel M. Clark. We'll see him again too. So he and 13 others who had previously been acquitted by the hanging jury were taken out and hanged by Bob Scott, Alexander Boutwell, former sheriff, acting as executioner, Borland commanding the militia, and William C. Young acting as prosecuting attorney. Grisly business. So they adjourn. They're going to come back in a week and let everybody go. Doesn't work out. Middle of the week, William C. Young is assassinated down on the Red River by unknown assassins. Turns out later it was some guys from his regiment that they thought he was coming to find them and make them go back into the army back in Mississippi. So they shot a guy that they thought was Young, and then when Young came down to investigate, they shot him. So the jury reassembles on the Saturday. By this time, the families are there, right? They've been told, come pick up your menfolk. No. The jury reconstitutes itself. Some jury members were gone. They were replaced with more radical men, as Barrett calls them. They can now get that two-thirds vote. They revisited the jury records, and they convicted now 19 previously acquitted men. 16 of them will be hanged on Monday, because when they went out there to hang them on Sunday, it was too cold. So after hanging 3 of them, they decided to come back on Monday and finish them off. That brings up our total to the 40 hanged and 2 shot. Again, Bob Scott driving the wagon, Boutwell serving as executioner. And also, he would do you a favor. If you wanted to write out a last will and testament, or maybe write a letter to your wife, he'd make sure that you got the pen and paper to do that, and he would deliver it. Some of those things still survive in the courthouse records over in Gainesville. Others have surfaced around the country. What do you do now? Well, the South generally supported Borland and what happened. Governor Lubbock kept his promise. The legislature reimbursed Hudson and Borland for everything they spent. Jefferson Davis was horrified, though. The stories of what was happening in Texas led him to throw out martial law in Texas and remove the Confederate commander of Texas and replace him with another one. Paul Octave Hebert was replaced with John Bankhead Magruder. So Borland loses his job as provost marshal, doesn't he? There's no more martial law. So his friends arranged for him to be commander of a special regiment called the Border Regiment, posted on the North Texas border to pretty much carry out what he'd been doing in the fall of 62. There's some interesting documents. By the spring of 64, his own officers are so disgusted with what he's doing that they file an official protest and ask for his removal because he's too often shooting prisoners who are trying to escape, much to their surprise. I'm sure some of them didn't know they were trying to escape. So Borland continues the task that he thought was necessary to crush the conspiracy, save North Texas, and keep the abolitionists and the Indians at bay all the way through the war. What about the North? They knew. This is the entire spread for the Frank Leslie's Illustrated Weekly, February 20th, 1864. There's the hanging picture right there. There's the rounding up part of it. There's Mrs. Hillier. Sumner wasn't there, so he got some things garbled. He said Bob Scott was used to whip some of the prisoners. I've never found corroboration of that. And what is this? Well, it's what I was telling people earlier. When Sumner ran away from North Texas and escaped, He was locked up in tiger cages in Little Rock, so that's part of his experiences. This was Little Rock. So what happens? What happens now? War's over. What happened to the families? Well, a lot of them fled. The women, I found through the blog site, a lot of them remarried. California, Midwest, Iowa, they scattered all over the place. A few stayed around. One that stayed around was Maholda. This is Nathaniel M. Clark's wife. You saw him earlier. He was hanged on October the 13th. This is his gravestone. It's still there. You can go visit. Prepare yourself to live and to die. I hope to meet you all in a better land. Last words, and they're engraved on his tombstone. Also engraved on the tombstone is the epitaph, murdered by a mob, October 13th, 1862. Well, so the families scatter. My favorite, though, is Ann Carpenter. Her husband, Sam Carpenter, was hanged. He was a local blacksmith. A lot of the local units, as they equipped, went to him to get horseshoes, bridles, all the detritus that you need for managing horses, because he's a blacksmith. A lot of people in town owed him money. He told Ann before he died, before he was hanged, you get back every dime those people owe me. By 1867, she owned two-thirds of the town lots in the town of Gainesville. She owned two-thirds of that town. She then sold it, married a new guy, and moved to California. She's tough. Why don't you put these people on trial? Think about it, guys. Who's going to be the jury in Gainesville? The same people who stood with you on the square in 62, aren't they? Some judges will try. Borland's particularly tough. He has a presidential pardon. After the Civil War, Andrew Johnson issued an amnesty proclamation. Borland applied under the 13th exception, which he applied admitting that he owned 20 or more slaves. He owned 25. He didn't mention being a provost marshal or anything like that. And it went forward to the White House from North Texas with endorsements of people that not Johnson knew and trusted. So Johnson pardoned him. It's a powerful document to have if you ever put on trial for what happened in Gainesville, isn't it? It's better than that, though. The legislature in 1866 faced a tough question. So they passed Ordinance Number 11. No man, no person could be prosecuted in Texas for any action taken under Confederate authority. Now, there's some logic to this. What if they arrested you for burglary, or rape, or assault in 1862, and you've been locked up at Huntsville ever since then? War ends, the Confederacy loses. What's one of the first things you're going to want your attorney to argue? I was arrested and convicted in jail by a bogus court, right? Nope, not gonna happen. What if grandma died in 64 and you don't like the way her will was probated? You can go back now and say, that was a Confederate court, it wasn't a real court. Legislature in 1866 says, yeah, it was a real court. It absolutely was a real court and their authority stands. But in writing the law so broadly, look what they just did for the Borlands of the world. He can't be prosecuted. So when you try to prosecute a man like James G. Borland, and they did, he's sitting there with a presidential pardon in his back pocket. It is Texas state law that he cannot be held liable for anything he did under Confederate authority. And he's got really smart attorneys who are defending him. Attorneys who, like him, served Texas in the Confederacy during the war. Like James Webb Throckmorton. First guy to vote against secession in the convention, one of the first guys to sign up with William C. Young, Throckmorton went on to be a brigadier general in Texas State Service, and James G. Borland's defense attorney for the only time he was ever brought to trial for what he did at the Great Hangings. Life and politics is just weird, isn't it? Why would he do that? Why'd the Warren Commission push through an explanation that a lot of people don't buy? Why do we put such things behind us and move on as quickly as possible? Because that's what Throckmorton thought was the right thing to do. Borland might be an SOB, but it's a new world. The country is coming back together, and there are bigger fish to fry. So Borland walks, Montague walks, Barrett walks, they all walk. None of them were ever convicted for very human reasons. I would never criticize the people of Gainesville for the decisions they made or the decision that Throckmorton made. What I try to do is explain it. Was it forgotten? As best locals could, they forgot it, but some wouldn't let them. Barrett wrote his account. As of 1960, there were only three known original copies of this, but Barrett wanted people to know. There was another account that had never been published until the 1960s. Some of Borland's allies, the Diamond Brothers, were very concerned that they might be arrested and prosecuted, so they hired their little brother to write an account. He was given the actual court records to write his account. Those court records have since disappeared. This is as close as we're going to get to knowing exactly what was said in that court. It's the fragments we have that were pulled back together, found actually in a family's archives in Dallas, and published in about 1961. Now, you can go hunt on eBay and get those two paper-bound accounts. I've got copies of them. Or last year, we published the two of them, Barrett's account and Diamond's account, together in one nice little volume with an intro written by me. And I got a couple of copies with me in case you really want one. Christmas is coming. Thought I'd throw that in. By the 1980s, the Clark family was beginning to insist that they wanted to be heard. L.D. Clark, his birthday was Tuesday this week. I had birthday cake with L.D. Clark. He's 91. He's Nathaniel M. Clark's grandson. He's still pissed. He went on to be a Ph.D. in English literature, taught for over 25 years at the University of Arizona, one of the reigning authorities on D.H. Lawrence, and he's pissed because they hanged his granddaddy in Gainesville, and he will not want anyone to ever forget that. So he actually edited his great uncle's account as this publication in the 1980s. He's put out a novel because he's an Englishman. You know, he's an English professor, right? So his forte is not history, it's writing novels. He's got a screenplay that he's trying to option. If you have a friend in Hollywood, please tell me. I'll put him in touch with LD. Because he calls me at least once a month asking if I found him an agent yet. Interesting guy. I put out The Great Hanging at Gainesville, Texas. There's a slightly modified version where I pass the blame to Lubbock in an essay I put out a couple of years ago, because when I wrote this book, I did not have the correspondence between Borland and Lubbock. Those have been resting in an archive in Galveston, the Rosenberg Library, where somebody took them years ago out of the Texas State Library and Archives. What will you find if you go to Gainesville? Will you find great markers? This is Young's grave marker. It's out in the middle of a pasture. William C. Young rests under a very simple marker. No great monuments for him. Borland, in an overgrown family cemetery behind a beat-up old house down by the river. Nobody remembers Borland except for his relatives and a few close alliances and their descendants. That's Barrett's marker. That's a good friend of mine named Steve Gordon. That is not Barrett. He's not still alive. But that's Barrett's marker. It's in somebody's side yard up under a nice tree. Again, nobody knows that it's there. Steve found it. That's where Thomas Barrett is buried, almost forgotten. Are you getting the impression that Gainesville just doesn't really want to remember? As well, they might not want to. So when they were forced in the 1960s to put up a marker to the Gainesville hanging, this is it. Quick, read it. I know, I'm cynical. But I happen to think that there's a reason why you can't read this dang thing. They use the speckled red granite. And everybody who looks at it says, I can't read that. And I smile and say, yeah, I know. It's in this park right here. Actually, this park right here is where the hanging probably took place. Half of it is now gone. They channelized the creek there. And then the mayor gave away another half of it so the Department of Transportation could park its gravel trucks on it. But he's 100% behind remembering the hangings, just in case you missed that part. But just like Barrett, there's somebody else alive today, barely, Leon Russell. In 2007, Leon Russell, who grew up in this area, hearing rumors of what had happened, contacted me. And yeah, I was all excited when somebody said, Leon Russell called and left you a message. It's like, really? Not that one. Damn. But Leon and his wife made 42 white crosses by hand, went out there, knows this man's in a wheelchair, put him out there with the permission in the park, got a Methodist minister to come say a few words, and held the first ever memorial service. And yes, people showed up and said, I didn't know this ever happened. Is there a book about this? Yeah, there's a book. Friends of mine saw this stuff on the internet. I had friends in England emailing me and saying, were you there? Yeah, I was there. So, today, there's a push to put a real marker out there. Leon is still alive, barely. As I told you, there was an event on Monday. And it galls their soul, the people who would like to have a real marker put up, that this is the main Confederate marker in Gainesville, Texas. It's a beautiful old courthouse, a very nice UDC marker, and less than 3 blocks from where 40 people were lynched from a tree, it says, home of tears, but let her bear this blazon to the end of time. No nation rose so white and fair, none fell so free of crime. That kind of bothers some people. By the way, where'd that come from? That was a Wolseley inscription on the flyleaf of his interpretation of Homer that he gave to Robert E. Lee in 1868. Philip Wolseley was an English scholar, and he wrote that. He was not thinking of Gainesville at the time. It's become a favorite inscription on Confederate monuments all the way over from Augusta and Savannah, Georgia, west to Texas. All the way back around to why talk about it. Because it's an issue that still deeply divides a small town. And in doing that, it shows the enduring impact of the war on us as a people, as a culture, as a state, and as a nation. It also undermines some of the false imagery that we're given about the Civil War. A monolithic Confederacy that just mindlessly and without a murmur marched lemming-like into a total disaster. Confederates, Texans at that time, were just as divided, just as contentious, just as cranky as we are. And when we learn our history properly, when we remember it warts and all, then I think we're better prepared to make the decisions we make and to make the policies that will bring us into the next 100 years of our history.